Welcome to Rome First United Methodist Church. Glad you decided to join us today. You're tuning in either by YouTube or on our website, www.romefirst.org. Welcome to this time of worship on Sunday, January the 23rd. You can check out all the activities and the things that are going on virtually by looking at our website. I'd like to bring a couple of things to your attention. You can sign up for several studies. For Dr. Gill's Bible study, which is yet to begin, stay tuned. Sign up, but stay tuned. We anticipate the beginning of that Bible study towards the end of February. You can sign up for my Lead and Learn class, which again is scheduled for the end of February. Sign up and stay tuned. And looking a little further out for the Lenten Bible study. This will be offered in several different locations. We'll be offering a Lenten lunch lift on Tuesdays beginning in March. So watch for more details, sign up, and stay tuned. Welcome to this time of worship. Be at peace, for we have gathered in the midst of the stuff of life to pause, to offer our thanks, to reflect, to sing together, to pray together, to worship together, even if in different spaces. We unite our hearts, our lives, and our love in coming to worship God. Come now with thankful hearts and let us join our voices as we sing and praise God. Amen.
Shall never his covenant remove. name shall stand forever. That name to us is love.
That name to us is love. As we continue to worship, would you join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed as together we unite in this historic confession of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
I invite you to join me from right where you are as we come before the throne of God's grace, lifting our prayers, our hopes, our dreams before God's presence. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we pause amid the stuff of life to bring to you our prayers, our hopes, our dreams, our heartaches, our doubts, the things that challenge us, O Lord. We lift them before you. And we acknowledge, O Lord, that you're ever more ready and willing to hear and to answer our prayers than we are to stop and to pray. We pray, O Lord, for many things. We pray for hope, for the hopeless. We pray for rest for those who are weary. We pray for compassion. For those who have suffered through the indignities of life. We pray for justice. We pray for mercy. We pray, O Lord, most of all, for your love and your peace, the peace that Jesus himself promised, a peace that would pass all understanding. Lord, you know, we need your peace, not only in our hearts and our homes, but we need your peace in our world. For given to our own reckless abandon. There is no peace. We pray, O Lord, for those who have suffered loss. We admit, O Lord, we shrink before the mystery of life and of death. And yet, our assurance is that this life is but a glimpse of eternity. We pray for those who travel and for traveling mercies. We pray for those who are wondering about your love, wondering about your mercy, wondering about your peace. Oh Lord, make us instruments of your love and your mercy and your peace, so that the world need not wonder, but that all the world might know of your great, abiding, unending grace, mercy, and love. We lift up these concerns before you, O Lord. The prayers we have spoken and those that remain unspoken in the depths of our hearts. And so now we join our voices. And with the confidence of little children, we pray together the prayer that Jesus himself prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. We would, if we were gathered together in this space, we would pass offering plates so that you might give of yourself and of your substance. Give so that the mission and the ministry of Rome First might be extended out these doors, across the street, across the state, and across this great terrestrial ball. Thank you for giving online. Thank you for mailing in your gifts, your offering, your tithe. Thank you for your faithfulness and for your support of the multitude of ministries and mission efforts that are supported through Rome First as a part of the United Methodist Connectional Church. The sun literally never sets on the ministry of the church. Thank you for being a part of that. Thank you for being faithful in your support. Now, would you receive this musical offering on this most glorious day? Amen. Thank you. For that beautiful offering to remind us, if ever we were loved and loved by God, it's now. Now, for not only the young, but the young at heart. Watch this.
Little people, here we are together on the second Sunday in the season after Epiphany, which is the day of the arrival of the wise men who come seeking God by light of the star. We are in the Gospel of John, right at the very beginning of now grown-up Jesus' ministry as he is just setting out. And Jesus and his disciples have been invited to a wedding at Cana. And at this wedding, at some point amongst all the celebrating, the wine runs out. And Mary, who does know who Jesus truly is and what he can do asks him to fix that. And Jesus doesn't want to. Of the 40-something miracles Jesus performed, this miracle is the very first one recorded, and it happens sooner than he's ready for. He says so, telling his mom, "My time is not yet come," but he does it anyway. With only the servants around to see him do it, Jesus takes the water that's left over at the wedding, turning it into wine. And little people, there are two reasons why this is my favorite miracle of Jesus. One, his glory is revealed here, that this party guest is God, the one the wise men were seeking and the one that we seek now, here in the flesh, living a life. And two, that God who lives among us obeys his mother, even though he doesn't really want to. His mother Mary already knows who he is and what he can do. And the disciples see him do this at the wedding, and they believe. And the servants at the party, they know something that the honored guests don't. And that is how Jesus does things. As we move together through this season of Epiphany, let's be like the wise men, seeking God in unexpected places. And like the servants, finding God doing amazing things behind the scenes. And like the disciples, we believe.
What's new? Good news? Good news isn't new. It just seems like it's hard to come by these days. Our scripture lessons for this Sunday come from Isaiah, the 61st chapter, the first verse, and then from Luke's gospel, the 4th chapter, verses 17 through 19. You'll see the words on the screen. I invite you to read along. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners. And from Luke's gospel, the 4th chapter, beginning in the 17th verse, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Good news. Couldn't we all use some more good news? Is 2022 a year of the Lord's favor? Consider this. These are ripped from the headlines. Tsunamis in Tonga. Wildfires in Colorado, California, and Oregon. The ongoing devastation of COVID. The Soviet Union poised to invade Ukraine. North Korea test launching missiles. Rising crime, rising inflation, increased teen suicides, declining consumer confidence. Where is the good news? David Brooks, a writer for the New York Times, published an article entitled "America is Falling Apart at the Seams." It profiles a culture in crisis. Brooks reports that reckless driving is rising, the number of altercations on airplanes is exploding, the murder rate in cities is surging, drug overdoses are increasing, Americans are drinking more, and nurses say patients are becoming more abusive. Teachers are facing a rising tide of disruptive student behavior. Drug deaths have risen continuously for 20 years, but shot up especially during the pandemic. The FBI states that hate crimes have surged to the highest level in 12 years. And now I add a parenthetical addition to David Brooks' article. The Southern Poverty Law Center in Montgomery, Alabama, listed at the beginning of this year, just a few days ago, that there are 41 active hate groups in the state of Georgia. Just let that sink in for a moment. And now back to the New York Times article, where David Brooks continues to describe and to enumerate the indicators of the crisis in our culture. He tells us that giving to charity is steadily declining, both to religious and to secular causes. Brooks sees a long-term loss of solidarity, a long-term rise in estrangement and hostility, and adds, "This is what it feels to live in a society that is dissolving from the bottom up as much as from the top down." Brooks asks, "What's going on?" And then he answers, "I don't know. I don't know what's causing high rates of depression, suicide, and loneliness that dogged Americans even before the pandemic, that are the sad flip side of all the hostility and recklessness that's been described." He notes also that church membership has fallen below 50% for the first time in U.S. history, and cites a report that our nation has the world's highest rate of children living in single-parent households. He also cites a Washington Post headline, "America is a nation of narcissists," and that's according to two new studies. Then he adds, "There must also be some spiritual or moral problem at the core of all of this. Over the past several years and over a wide range of different behaviors, Americans have been acting in fewer pro-social and relational ways and in more antisocial and self-destructive ways. But why?" Brooks concludes his article writing these words, "As a columnist, I'm supposed to have some answers, but I just don't right now. I just know the situation is dire." And then the article ends. Dire straits. That doesn't sound like good news. A friend who called me recently told me about his battle with depression and anxiety. And then he went on in the telephone conversation to tell me about all the television news programs that he watches, and that they all only seem to report doom and gloom. After listening to him for a little over 5 minutes, I said, "Why don't you just turn off the TV? If it's making you anxious or depressed, just turn it off." He said, "Well, what would I do?" I said, "Well, what if you got involved in your community right around you? Used your skill and your talent and your abilities and the grace that God's given you to make a difference right where you are. It might change your attitude and it might help you to feel less anxious." And he asked, "Well, that's well and good, but how can I make a difference? After all, I'm just one person." And I said, "Start where you are with what you have and aim to make a difference." I offered him this quote from Bertha Calloway: "We can't direct the wind, but we can adjust our sails." We can't do anything about the wind or the lack thereof. All we can do is adapt to it. With the wind, we can just adjust our sails or adjust our approach, tacking instead of making a long sail on the run against the wind. But we cannot change the wind. We need to adapt. And why is adaptation so important? Adaptation is a powerful word. Darwin used it, and it changed the face of science. Adaptation is, by its theory, a way that life has progressed, regardless of how you feel about Darwinism and how the evolution of species might explain life how we know it now. Adaptation at the personal level is required not only to survive, but to thrive. Adaptation is how we move forward. We adapt to the changes in our world as humans. First, by learning how to move our limbs and progressing to the crawl, walk, run sequence. We adapt to learning better methods of communication by moving from crying to pointing to speaking. The prophet Isaiah proclaimed, and Jesus announced the fulfillment of the prophecy. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners. As my friend asked, where do we begin if we want to be messengers of good news? Is there a governmental or institutional solution? No. Why not begin with right where we are, with what we have, and focus on doing what we can? And what can we do? Share the good news. The good news that we have heard, the good news that we have received, the good news that we believe. And we believe it to be good news because it has changed our life and has the capacity to change the world. Cultural anthropologist Margaret Mead, in her book, Continuities in Cultural Evolution, writes these words: never depend upon institutions or government to solve any problem. All social movements are founded by, guided by, motivated, and seen through by the passion of individuals. If you see the world in dire straits, what are you doing to change the course? Maybe you say to yourself, as my friend did, I can't change the world. But I say to you, maybe you can't change the world, but you can change you. And every single change has a ripple effect. Consider the story of Segi Tekeltenshin, 52 years old. She goes by the name Jenny. She immigrated from Ethiopia to Columbus, Ohio 20 years ago. She used to be a senior banker for an investment bank, and she drove Uber on Friday and Saturday nights to raise money to help an orphanage in Ethiopia, as well as to meet new people and to share the good news of God's great love through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Almost 8 months ago, Jenny quit her full-time, well-paid job to take care of an 88-year-old neighbor who had been recently diagnosed with dementia. The neighbor's name is Paul Webb. Jenny recalls when she first met Paul at the end of February in 2020. He had called for an Uber and wanted to visit a restaurant, but everything was closed due to COVID. She still picked him up and drove him to the Verizon store so he could get his phone fixed. Jenny, who is the mother of two, lives nearby and gave Paul her personal phone number, saying that she could see that he was lonely and needed help. Paul called her the very next day. They went to the store to buy milk. And after that, Jenny said, I started to see him more and more, and I built a relationship. I feel like he's my dad. And doing this gives me satisfaction of doing good. Jenny connected with Paul's son and daughter by phone in early 2020. As her role in Paul's life grew more and more involved, but it was hard to earn their trust because, after all, here was an outsider providing help to their father. Because of their distance from their father, they could not provide it themselves. Paul's son, Keith, said it just took time. My wife and I prayed for someone to come into my dad's life. And lo and behold, Jenny said she would care for my dad because the Lord told her to. In 2021, Jenny committed to stay with Paul each day. And he asked Paul's children only to pay her half of what she was paid as an investment banker. As they built a strong bond by that time, Paul was very happy for Jenny to be his caregiver. So for the past 8 months, a normal day for Paul and Jenny starts around 10 a.m. with medication, with breakfast and prayer, before washing and dressing and heading out to a restaurant, perhaps for lunch. They run errands, they watch TV, they talk, they take walks if the weather's good. You see, Paul was officially diagnosed with dementia in 2017 after a stroke. Keith, Paul's son, says his father was pretty independent until roughly about 2 years ago, at which point Keith and his sister struggled to provide the care he needed. Jenny's appearance and her consistency were the answer to their prayers. Keith said, "Isn't it comforting to know that in an age of self-centeredness and hopelessness, in a culture of hopelessness, that God is faithful and God is good, and anything is possible with God?" Indeed, anything is possible with God, because God is good, and Jesus not only comes to proclaim the good news, Jesus is the embodiment, the incarnation of the good news of God's great love. Jesus was anointed and appointed not only to proclaim the good news. Jesus is the good news. If we were to look at Luke's gospel immediately following the passage of scripture we read early, we'd see Jesus hand the scroll of the prophet Isaiah back to the attending rabbi, and he intones these words, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Today, the scripture has been fulfilled. Now, good news is not a glossing over or ignoring the challenges of the stuff of life that surround us. Good news is, at its best, applying the gifts, talent, skills, grace each of us has been given to change the story. We are created with volition or free will. We can choose how we respond in any given situation or circumstance. Again, I'm going to quote from Margaret Mead. "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has." I close with this story. Perhaps you've heard it before. It's entitled, "Whose Job Is It Anyway?" It's a story about four individuals named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. There was an important job to be done, and everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry that nobody did it because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it. It ended up that everybody blamed somebody when nobody did what anybody could have. Well, maybe you were confused by that story, but the message is clear. No one took responsibility, so nothing got accomplished. What are you willing to do? What are you willing to do to be a proclaimer of the good news? Look around. Opportunity abounds. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we thank you that you have entrusted us as messengers of the good news. Jesus has been anointed and appointed to proclaim the acceptable year of your favor. We have heard and received that message of hope, that good news. May it resonate in our minds, and may it be echoed from mountain top to mountaintop to the ends of this earth, that your great love through your Son Jesus Christ is good news. Good news indeed. This is our prayer, and we make it in the name of Jesus the Christ. And all God's children said, Amen. In order to have the good news, we have to seek it. So invite you to sing along. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. prepare to go from this place out to wherever you go. You go with the hope, the peace, the joy of God's great love in Christ. That's good news. Take the good news. Be the good news. Here, there, and everywhere. And a closing thought. It comes from Hillel the Elder. If not you, then who? And if not now, then when? Go and take the good news of God's great love wherever you go. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.